I'm impressed by the number of people who are coming. Yeah, I don't know. I know that some people were interested in to know what Skyrmions are, but okay. It's very good. I'll give a little introduction to Skyrmions. Today, only at the classical level, so it's basically only classical theory, so not even quantum mechanics or whatever. And we can have a second lecture, I don't know, for instance, next week at the same time. Or we can, if it fits, and see how many people are there, apparently Wednesday afternoon is the time. Okay, well, we can discuss afterwards. If you're still interested to know about the quantization. But. Okay, first the classical level, so yeah. Maybe I should say why I'm doing this. This is because of my Skyrmions were a big part of my PhD thesis, actually. And it's a bit a non-canonical subject in quantum field theory, because it's somehow old and gave results, but it's not very popular now. Although in condensed matter physics, it's quite a hot topic at the moment. Okay, what are Skyrmions? So Skyrmions are solid things. So what are solid things? There are a number of that's the thing. You can interrupt me all the time, right? It's meant to be a bit informal. So I do it on the blackboard, so that I don't jump over steps. Hopefully. So what are solitons? There are a number of definitions of solitons, but one thing is they are solutions of the field equation. So basically an exponent of the action. I will even limit myself to only static solutions of the field equation. Which means that the time independent solutions. This is going
to solitons are static solutions. What other solutions can be called the solitons?
The thing is, you can have moving soliton, which is a non-static solution.
Mm-hmm. No, what I understand is the spatial profile remains the same as it
exactly.
goes
to
exactly. Time.
So it is.
The
question is, what do you call
what
it
is
static,
the meaning of static?
So they are static. It's a good definition, but you can have a moving soliton, which is a time-dependent solution. I will consider really time-independent solution. You can always Lorentz boost. Of this thing to be addressed.
They're instant
on. Instantons are not in this category, actually. So
this happens in time.
Yes.
I mean, instantons are in Euclidean space time.
Yes.
Exactly.
And one important property of solitons is their finite size and finite energy. So there basically, if you want, the field around the soliton is in the vacuum, but there is a place in space that is going to be like a knot or something like this, that is going to have a special configuration. I will just start with a warming up example in 1+1 dimension. This is the easiest way to grasp that. There is a model there that is called the Sine-Gordon model, after the Klein-Gordon equation. Someone made the plan of changing Klein-Gordon to Sine-Gordon, just because the potential is actually a cosine, not a sine. So if you want, the model, the Lagrangian, is just a scalar field in 1+1 dimension, plus a potential, and this potential I will take it to be just 1 minus cosine of phi. Okay, this is a very basic potential. So this gives actually the field equation for this thing is just d squared phi minus, to make sure that
you
the right
use
side,
a,
plus sine phi equals 0. And this looks like the Klein-Gordon equation, but with the sine phi instead of the master. This is where the name sine Gordon comes from. Okay.
Do you use a minus plus measure?
A plus minus. Minus minus. We're always doing particles.
Yeah.
I'm not sure I get dimensions right here. So this is the Lagrangian density.
Yes, so I don't care too much about dimension, actually.
Phi should be dimensionless.
No, actually in two dimensions, it's in one plus one dimension, so phi is even dimensionless.
It's dimensionless, so yes. The first term is dimension 2 and the other is dimension 0.
Exactly, so you're right. So this is not
by mass squared.
By some coefficient. That is a dimension mass square. Oh, you're right. Absolutely. Okay, but let's forget a bit about this. I rescale my...
Just to show
the little thing. Exactly. No, absolutely. okay. Of course, this model is... Okay, probably you've seen this before, because this is just the potential of a pendulum. So basically, this model, if you want, you can put it as a set of pendula or something like this on the line, like the continuum limit of the set of coupled pendulum with some little string attached to make this thing continuous. So it's just describing this pendula. And of course, the vacuum in this case is just this. Anything that minimizes the potential is pi being equal to 2 from k to pi, where k is an integer number. So there are an infinite set of vacua in this model. And of course, there is a global also symmetry. You can shift the phi by any factor of 2 pi. So basically, you can say the true vacuum is phi equals 0. This is going to be useful for what we do. So let's go back to the definition of a soliton. A soliton is has finite size and finite energy. So it means that away from the soliton, we want to be in the vacuum. So a soliton in this case must impose that phi at minus infinity in space is some multiple of pi. I can choose 0. Because there's this global symmetry. And then phi at infinity, plus infinity, are required, must also be a number of multiple of pi, but then in this case it can be any number to n pi, where n belongs to, n is an integer. Okay, and of course, you see that for n equals 0, the solution to this equation is just phi equals to 0. So I can find a solution basically to this field equation for different n. For n equals to 0, the solution is phi equals 0. For n equals to 1, I can find another solution, which is actually for for arctangent of the exponential x minus x 0. Okay, and this describes basically a soliton at position x0. What does it mean? It's in terms of this pendulum, is if you rotate this thing, I will try to draw this thing, which is not going to end up well, but I'll try anyway. It's basically you have this pendulum like this, and at some point you have the pendulum being rotated, it's continuous, so we can make a loop like this. Probably not going to be very convincing. There are plenty of nice illustrations of this on Wikipedia, for instance. If you just give Simon Gordon a model. Okay. Very good. So, and you see that if you have a configuration like this, this can move around sometimes, like, but there is no way you can get rid of this winding here. Unless you have to go to infinity, but that you need infinitely much energy to do this. So this is an absolutely stable thing.
Can you repeat again these boundary conditions?
So the only requirement that I do is I want to look for a solution that has a finite size. So I know that at infinity I must be in the vacuum. And I choose, at minus infinity, I choose 0, because I can choose any vacuum. I can do a global transformation. And at plus infinity, then I have a number of possibilities, basically. Yeah. And this will fix Then with this boundary condition and this equation, I just get this game.
Actually,
I can take the plus or minus one solution, just the plus minus here. And this thing is stable, but you see that if you have a soliton and an anti-soliton, so a soliton of one in number one and a soliton of one in number minus one, you can collide them and they can uneven. So maybe this is the downside of being on the blackboard, is I cannot show a good animation of this. My drawing abilities are very limited. Okay.
So far these are configurations, they're not particles.
They are not particles.
So what do you mean by colliding them?
Because you can have a solution actually once
can
you see this equation.
Them, no.
Sorry?
You can do a linear combination of them.
You can do a linear combination of them, that's true. Yeah, but the thing is they are very well separated. So if you look, actually let me write down what is the energy associated with this thing. The energy is just the integral minus infinity to plus infinity of just minus the Lagrange for a static configuration, right? So if I just plug into this thing, the solution here for n equal plus or minus 1, I get... actually, where is this thing? It's 4 over cosine squared. Hyperbolic cosine squared. X squared is 0 squared. And this, if I integrate this, is going to give me 8. There is a problem with the dimension. I didn't put any dimension here, but let's not care about this. Because it's not the number. The important thing is, if I draw this energy, it's going to look like this, basically. The energy, this thing is 0, except around x0. And around x0, it's doing this. So see, this soliton is very local. If you go away from it, it's going exponentially fast to the vacuum.
So
it has some kind of size, basically, you can define.
So this is the energy density that we
have. This is the energy density.
This is minus the Lagrangian.
Yeah, basically minus.
It's minus the Lagrangian, if you want. But for a static solution, it's the same thing. As a function of x. Okay. And the point is, since this equation is actually Lorentz invariant, you can boost one of these things. So what I meant by colliding is basically you can have, you know, you can have one soliton somewhere and very far away another soliton. And it's in a good approximation, it's the solution of the field equation. And then you can have them move together. And if you go on the Wikipedia page of the sign Gordon, you have plenty of nice animation. Maybe you can even show it.
They're moving together, I don't understand. They are time independent, you say.
They are time independent, but you can do a time dependent solution by just boosting it, because this equation is Lorentz invariant. But for what I want to say, actually, it's enough to consider it alone.
Okay. So you get the solution by requiring that the solution doesn't depend on that.
Yes. Yes, yes.
So what happens to the energy of the invariant?
It's going to be dissipated into... It's classical field theory, so you're going to generate waves, but that are not... Actually, at the classical level, there is no actually, they will annihilate, but create again a pair of solitons. So, if you want, at some point you have no soliton in the solution, but you will.
But only for an instant.
Yes, exactly, only for an instant. Exactly. Okay. So this is just the simplest idea of what a soliton is. It's really, you know, you can see it in terms of this bandula. It's something I don't know. I remember having this. At the undergrad, like an experiment, really someone showing it. And it's a very easy, I don't know if it's easy, but visual thing to think of. Now, the point is we want to generalize this to 3 plus 1 dimension. And this is where things start to get a bit tricky. But what I want to do is do the same thing, take a model in 3 dimension, and see that requiring to have a finite size solution, so to be in the vacuum far from the origin, just imposing this boundary condition and look at what are the solution of the field equation. All right. What we can learn maybe from this also is that there are solitons because the vacuum is non-trivial actually. From the vacuum manifold, vacuum to M, which is the set of all fields such that the potential is zero. In this case, is these 2k pi, so it's isomorphic to just the set of integer basically. And that's an important requirement. If you have only a single vacuum, like usually you have in pi to the 4 theory or something like this, you don't have this kind of solutions. Of solitons.
But you could get some, but then they have infinite energy.
You can find a solution of the field equation with infinite energy. I don't know exactly. I don't know. You mean in phi to the 4 in 2 dimension?
I don't know anything about.
I don't know. This is the most typical example of solid on this sine Gordon model. By the way, if you want, I can provide my notes. They are handwritten, so not very good. But if you don't want to take notes, don't worry. Okay. All right. So how do we generalize this to 3 dimension? Of course. Look, this example, in principle, I could just decide now, okay, say, look, I take the same model in 3 dimensions, and actually, I will also find a solution like this that depends only on in x. So I could generalize this thing to 3 plus 1 dimension, but just saying I've got a solution that has a zero derivative with respect to y and to z. And the x dependence is given by this thing. So basically, this would be my 3 plus 1 dimensional puzzle, 3D space, basically. I'm lacking a dimension on the blackboard, but yeah, that's life. Basically, what I would get is some kind of domain walls that separate for x smaller than x is 0. I'm in the vacuum phi equals 0, and for x bigger than x 0, I'm in the vacuum phi equals to n pi, so 2 n pi. And in between, I have something that looks like this. Of course, in 3 plus 1 dimension, the energy of this thing is going to be infinite, because it extends it to infinity in other directions. But okay, so what tells us that there is a soliton in there? In 3 plus 1 dimension. It's a bit more complicated than in 1 plus 1 dimension. Because in 1 plus 1 dimension, if you want the winding number, this n, you can just write it as phi of infinity minus phi of minus infinity divided by 2 pi. And this is an integer, and this gives you the winding number of your soliton in this case. And you see that this thing is an invariant, because if you do an infinitesimal transformation of phi, this cannot change, unless you do you change phi at infinity, but you don't want to do that, because you change the energy by an infinite amount. So what is going to tell us that there are solitons in 3 plus 1 dimension is actually the topology of the vacuum manifold. And now I have to do a little bit of mathematics, which is probably the hard part of this. There is something to characterize the topology of the vacuum manifold. Okay, maybe I should say a word about the vacuum manifold is a bit scary word. But the manifold is just a space, it's a continuum. And what I mean by topology is that, for instance, let's say in the standard model is very simple. In the Higgs vacuum has this U1 symmetry before electric symmetry breaking. So in this case, you have a vacuum, and you can do a U1 rotation, and you're still in the same vacuum. So the vacuum manifold is, in the standard model, is something that is isomorphic to U1. But, okay, very good. Now, a little bit of topology. So, I will introduce the notion of homotopy group. First, the definition, don't be scared, and then what it is and the way we use it. So the nth homotopy group, this phi n of some manifold, is the nth homotopy group. Is the set of homotopy classes of the maps. It's a bit scary, yeah, for physicists like me. The set of homotopy classes of the maps. There's some maps from the n-dimensional sphere to this vacuum manifold. So this doesn't tell you much, of course, because there is again this homotopy class. So what is an homotopy class is we say that two maps are in the same homotopy class, F1 and F2, are in the same homotopy class if they can be continuously deformed from one another, from one to the other. It's a bit scary thing. And the other thing I should say is what is this n-dimensional sphere? Is like S1 is just the circle. S2 is what we call the sphere, actually, in three dimensions. So it is a two-dimensional surface in three dimensions. This was two. And actually, also an important one is S0. Which is just the sphere on the line, which is basically, if you have a sphere located here, it's basically this point here and this point here. So it's just two points. That's zero, right? Good. Why do we need this thing? Just one or two examples, because it's very abstract. So the simplest thing is, of course, this pi zero. What? The zeroth homotopy group. So the zeroth homotopy group, pi zero, is just basically thing if you map S zero, so two points into a manifold, if they can be continuously deformed to one to the other. So for instance, pi zero, let's say, of z. That is the set of integer. So I just said that I have one point, the point p1. So this map is taking p1 basically to some point, like it's a zero, and now the second point to one. Obviously, I cannot deform zero. Go from 0 to 1 inside Z. So actually, In this case, this is not going to be zero, it's going to be zen. It's a bit,
That is not really a manifold.
It's just, no, that is not a manifold, that's true. Actually, it's even more general, this thing. But so let's forget about this example. But you agree that the circle is a manifold. So on a circle, it's a different story, because when you have a circle, you can take any 2 points, you can always move them together. So this is a trivial homotopy group, which basically we say the homotopy group is just the neutral element, just zero. Why is it interesting? Because then there is this first homotopy group of S1. This is basically you're on a circle, and you draw a circle on this circle. So you start here, a circle, yeah, something. So you go around here and come back, and come back here. For instance, this is one possibility to draw a circle on a circle. There is another possibility to draw a circle on a circle, the circle here is you start from here, and you go around here, and you end up at the same point. And you see that there is a difference between these two things. This can be shrinked to a point, and this cannot be shrinked to a point. And then there is even another possibility. You can, on this circle, you can go once around, and not hit here, and come again to this point.
How do you miss
and
a point?
And this is winding number two.
On a point.
Sorry?
How do you miss a point on a line?
Ah, you don't solve it. You know, it's a map, so basically you say from in this case, okay, let me draw. For instance, in this case you say to each that's actually the target space and not your starting space, right? So you say for each point on the sphere, for instance. So it's a number from between 0 and pi, and 2 pi. You map this to a single point, for instance, to 1, to 0. This would be this trivial map. You can have this map that maps x to x, and you can have this map that maps x to x. So basically, you know, there is a coordinate in here, so this you say when this is when you're at pi here, you move to 2 pi in this circle. So it's a bit,
So Mark,
it's the physicist's definition of
with complex numbers is even easier, right?
With complex numbers?
Right, so these maps are just set to the end. And if you consider S1 to be the unit circle on the complex plane,
mm-hmm.
I mean, all these maps are just set to the end.
That's yeah, exactly. Exactly. Yeah, that's right. For yeah, exactly. But even in yeah. Of course. Yeah. But then the thing is you can extend this to the second homotopy group and then you cannot use the complex plane. So I don't know if you see
what is the homotopy group here?
In this case it's Z, because basically you can go once around, you can go any number of time around the circle. It's
yeah.
The only deformation that you could, it's the only non-trivial topology.
So the homotopy classes are just the natural integers.
Yes, it is isomorphic. Actually, I could use something else here. Instead of z, I could say the elements any multiple of pi or something like this. It's just isomorphic to the integer, actually. That's more correct. Very good. Okay, yes. And for instance...
Phi 2 of S1, then.
For instance, yeah, phi 2 of S1 is interesting.
So...
Because this...
Can I just ask another question?
Yes.
So phi 0 of S1 is 0, because there's only one way to do it. It's not
yes,
it's not to be confused with the empty set.
No, exactly. It's not the empty set. It's the
okay.
set with one element. There is
okay.
only one way
to
put 2 points
right.
on a circle.
Okay.
Only any other way is similar. You can always deform.
Mm-hmm.
But there are z different ways of putting
yes.
a circle on a circle. And for instance, pi 2 of S1 is 0 again. Because there is... if you put a circle on a sphere, you can always contract it to a point. You know, you take a sphere, and you have a circle that goes around, for instance, like this. You can always, like, shrink it to this side or something, to the point where it's a point. Whatever circle you draw on a sphere, you can shrink it to a point.
So pi n of
and actually
m
any higher number is going to be zero.
Exactly.
Or that's even a theorem for sphere is the same thing. And for instance, pi 3 of or
no,
no
is,
if I
isn't
take
that right there the pi 1 of s type 1 of s 2? Because now you're mapping a circle onto a sphere.
That's
the same thing.
Actually, it's the same
thing.
I'm
not saying it's not zero. I'm just saying
it is zero, actually. Pi 1 of S2 is zero. And pi 2 of S2 is not zero.
Is pi n of Sm
pi n of Sn
equal
n
to
is,
pi?
Pi n of Sn is always that, basically. This becomes difficult to visualize, because basically this is how you put... You cannot peel an orange without breaking the skin. This is what this means. Topology tells you that. Is that you have a sphere on a sphere, and you cannot shrink it to. I mean,
is it always true that, well, that pi n of S m is only
is
set
yes.
if they're equal and zero if they're different?
I think it's the case for a sphere, yes. But then where it gets interesting is that you can do this homotopy group for Lie groups, for instance. And for instance, if you take SU2, the thing is SU2 is isomorphic to SO3, which is itself isomorphic to the 3 sphere, no? SO3 is just an angle, basically. So SU2 has... Pi 0 of SU2 is 0. Pi 1 of SU2 is 0. Pi 2 of SU2 is 0. It's a bit boring, but that's it. But pi 3 of SU2 is actually that. There are a few subtleties about these SU2 being isomorphic to this thing.
I think you are off by one, because SO3 is S2.
Yeah,
that's what
I was thinking too.
Yeah.
This is correct. So where is the...
No,
because SO3 as if you don't... So it is like a sphere. This is a bit tricky. I guess you have to forget this.
This has an angle.
You have a three coordinates parametrizing SO3 or SU2, basically. So it's a three-dimensional surface. Well, actually, this is not even true. This is not even true, sorry. This is actually SU2, where you identify the infinity to a single point. It's a bit more... let me come to the back to that.
Yeah, okay. Pi 4 of SU2 is 0.
This is where it gets tricky, because if I remember well, because this is the same for any SUN, but then pi 4 is not the same for any SUN. Pi 4 of SU2...
Well, I think it's easier in this case, because I mean SU2 is really S3 topologically, because it's not unitary but elements. I mean, you can really see it as a 3 sphere in R4,
exactly.
So it's 0.
SU2, yes, yeah, okay. So exactly, that's the thing, the pi 4 of SU2 is 0, but if you take pi 4 of SU3, for instance, it's not 0.
That's another story.
That's another
this
story.
This is only for SU2, which is exactly SU2.
Exactly, SU2 is a bit special, but actually you can do the same thing for any SUN, this is always valid.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's also
not the pi 4, which is an interesting thing. Okay, good. Yes. Why did I do this painful thing of telling you what is a homotopy group? Is that this is telling, it's telling us directly if there are solitons in a field theory, actually.
Yes.
So you know you have a theory, so you look at the vacuum of your theory, which is a classically it's a very easy thing to do, right? You just find the minimum of the potential. And and then you look at what these homotopy groups are. Actually, looking at all the homotopy groups, you know all about the topology of the vacuum manifold.
So there can be solitons only when the homotopy group.
They can be solitons only if the some homotopy groups are non-zero, and then the kind of soliton that it is depends on what it is. So if you have pi zero of your vacuum manifold that is non-zero, then you can have dominoes. This is the maybe the easiest to realize, because what this means just means that the vacuum manifold is disconnected, so you can have different regions of space that are in a different vacuum, and in between the fields have to map the two regions. So you have some object that is called a domain wall, but I will not go into the details into this thing. If you have pi 1, it is non-zero, then it means that you can have cosmic streams here. So not yeah. Which is something you have probably, at least the astrophysicists have probably heard about. It was very hot topic 20 years ago, but now it's not. The thing is, there is experimental evidence that there are no, I think, cosmic streams. And what is this? It's like actually, you can have in space, you can have an object that is physically like a string. And what this thing means is that there are different closed path that you can draw in space. This is a closed path that is going to have a trivial, that is trivial, but you can have a closed path that goes around the string, basically. And if you have different type of closed path that are not related, it means that somewhere you have a string like this. And these strings are interesting, because when you look at them, what you see is you have an angular defect in there. So you can see if you have a star, if you look from this side actually, and you have a star here. You can see it twice. No?
I think the constraint
like lensing, or is it the opposite way around?
No, it was just this constraint of strings is just depending on the tension. I mean, I think they're not ruled out. It's just that.
Okay. Sure. Okay. So I don't know anything about the phenomenology of this thing, but So there is this possibility. If pi 1 is non-zero, there is a possibility of having cosmic string. If pi 2 of the vacuum manifold is non-zero, then you can have monopoles. And it's the same thing. So a monopole is a point-like object, if you want, in space. And you can have so pi 2 is a two-dimensional surface, so basically a sphere. If you take a sphere here, in the vacuum, it has a trivial topology. And if you take a sphere around the monopole, then you will see, by looking at the gauge field around this thing, that this sphere has something inside. See? So this is why.
So
if you have this difference, then you have monopole. You can have monopole.
So pi 2 of U1 is not zero.
Pi 2 of U1 is 0, but pi 1 of U1 is non-zero. So actually, you can have cosmic string in the standard model. You could,
but isn't
you
the,
can, actually, but...
Isn't the electron a monopole in this context?
No. In grand unified theory, where you have a vacuum manifold that usually you have... Like, for instance, this Georgi and Glashow model, you have SU2 symmetry broken to U1.
Mm-hmm.
And pi 2 of SU2 broken to U1. So the vacuum manifold is this coset. And this is non-zero. This is, again, the and so you can have monopoles in this thing. Actually, in SUN broken to SUN minus 1, I think you always have this thing, if I'm correct. What I have to say also is that this is a necessary condition to have solitons, but it's not a sufficient condition. And the last thing is what is going to interest us is of course is pi 3 of the vacuum manifold that is non-zero, then you can have skyrmions. Actually, you can have textures. This is a more general thing, but I know only one model that has this is this time on the line. Why is it going to be a scary? Very good. And this gets very hard to visualize. So because you have to think of a three-dimensional surface winding around something. So I will not draw anything there. Otherwise...
Does Skyrmion mean anything in English?
Skyrmion means the name of the guys who invented them is Tony Skyrm, actually. Who lived from 1922 to 1987. So he's a British physicist. That's where the name comes from. Very good. Yes. Okay. Let's... yes. So now, before... Maybe we can even take a little break. But before that, let me just show a last thing. Is that this... thing is a necessary condition to have solitons, but it's not a sufficient condition. Actually, in four dimension, there is a theorem, which is called Derek's theorem, which is a very simple theorem, so I can even give it to you, is that if you take a scalar field in 3 plus 1 dimension, the Lagrangian is just what I had before, basically, with a potential, and they cannot be solitons in this kind of theories. And why is that? Is that let's assume that there is a soliton. So let's assume that there is a field phi zero. I mean, a given configuration phi zero. That is a soliton configuration. So it's not this is a given function. Okay. The energy of this thing, as I had before, and it's a static solution. So the energy is as before is minus the Lagrangian integrated over space. So it's just and there is no, it's static, so it's just the space component. Now for this specific I zero, this is some value, and let me call the first part the part that contains this derivative dependent term u one, and this term with the potential I call this u two. This is just u 1 plus u 2. Okay, so assuming that phi zero is a soliton. Then I can look at what the energy is. So the fact that it's a soliton means that it's a minimum of the energy. So if I do dE d phi at phi zero, I get zero. And the second derivative at phi equals phi zero must be positive, so that it's a local minimum. This is our working assumption, that phi zero is a field configuration that works like this. So what I can do is I can look at another field configuration that I call phi lambda, which is just phi lambda of x, is just phi zero of lambda times x, which lambda is a number, so I just rescale my soliton, right? So if I do that, I can compute the energy of this... this is the configuration phi lambda, and you can just do a change of variable actually from lambda x to x, and this will just rescale the coordinates. So from this d cube x, you'll get 1 over lambda cube, and here there is an extra derivative. So basically, if I do that, I get 1 over lambda times e1 plus 1 over lambda cubes times e2. Okay, this is just the energy of my soliton configuration just rescaled. And this must be indeed the minimum of the action. So if I take the derivative of this with respect to the lambda, at lambda equals to 1, I want this to be 0. At lambda equals to 1, this must be 0. And if I do it here, I get minus 1 mu 1 minus 3 e 2. Right? So this must be 0. So this means that I have e 2, which must be minus 1 third e 1. OK. And then, very good. But then I also want to do the second derivative of this. By lambda, at lambda equals to 1. I just rewrite this condition, right? This I would like it to be positive, but if I compute it, I get, it's always very bad to take a derivative live on the blackboard. So let me check this. It's just 2 times E1. It's 12 times E2, right? And so if I know that E2 must be minus 1 third E1, I just get minus 2 times E1. But this is a problem, because this is negative. Because E1 is just the energy associated with the kinetic term of the field phi. So if I have a soliton, then I find that actually it cannot be a minimum of the energy, so they cannot be solitons. So the conclusion of Derek's theorem, which is a reason why people didn't study solitons too much in plus one dimension, is that they cannot be stable solitons. But of course, I did it for a scalar field and for a renormalizable theory, because the way out of this is actually to have terms with more derivatives. Yeah. You see it, because it's just,
yeah, don't get
just a scaling, right? It counts the number of derivatives of the field. So if you have the terms with more derivative, you'll get a different scaling with lambda. And you can get out of this problem. Okay.
But I mean, in a gauge theory, that could be different.
A gauge theory could be different, but then if you have just a gauge theory, it's the same thing. You can apply the same argument. You can rescale the gauge field, actually. The only thing is the gauge field scales like a derivative, but as dimension one.
Sure.
But it's the same argument applied, actually, in the gauge field alone.
So a normalizable theory in four dimensions cannot have scalars. That is true.
I'm not sure, actually. I'm not sure. I'll ask this question myself, and I couldn't never find the claim strong enough. For scalar field theory, normalized scalar field, there is no solitons. All kind of solitons, not only skyrmions, no monopoles. But for instance, you can have you have monopoles in the Georgian classical model, so obviously there is a way out of this, which is renormalized. It's not actually true. Good. So I'm done with the very basic introduction on solitons. So I'm only halfway of what I plan to do today. And, already nearly an hour, so I don't know, or maybe a bit more than halfway. But should we take a little break?
Yeah, let's take 10 minutes break.
Let's take 10 minute break, and then continue. Thanks. Okay, so now we go back a bit to more physics and less mathematics. And okay, so now I'm going to introduce what is known as the Skyrm model. Because it introduced actually in a 1961 paper by Tony Skyrm, but it's apparently a much older idea, because Skyrm was a bit like Higgs. He was not very prolific in publishing, apparently. Many of his ideas were never published, apparently, but yeah. So, you know that the low energy description of pi on physics is in terms of a nonlinear sigma model. So the pi on Lagrangian
basically can be written as f pi square of 4, but this is a constant which coincides with the pi and the constant actually. As a trace of the dagger, where U is an SUN, SU2 matrix. I will take only the case of just two flavors, so up and down. This is basically the exponential in terms of the pi field. This pi field, and I take the Pauli matrices here, which is a bit an unconventional normalization because it's way of a factor of 4 here, while if you take all the matrices over 2, you don't need the factor of 4. And this belongs to SU2. This is SU2 matrix. Okay, and this Lagrangian describes the pion interaction. I leave to you as an exercise to do this exponential. But you know, if you do this, what you get here is that you get basically d mu pi, scalar product, well, this pi vector is just a pi component. And then plus 1 over 6 f pi squared. Pi square minus pi square pi square. So all the interaction of pi is actually characterized by this nonlinear interaction. So everything is included.
Is this an exact or to some order?
It's to some order. Sorry, yes. So this is, of course, plus correction for the 1 over pi to the 4th. And this Lagrangian is also not complete yet, but I will come back to it.
That's a non-linear sigma model.
It's a non-linear sigma model. This is just the SU2 non-linear sigma model.
Only that you have expanded the...
I've just expanded because it's nice to see. So, you know, this Lagrangian, at the Lagrangian level, as a global SU2 left times SU2 right symmetry. Because you can rotate, see, the U is in, the Lagrangian invariant under left multiplication of U by a C2 matrix, but also a right multiplication. So there is this global thing. But of course, the vacuum, where all the pi fields are set to zero, is just the identity matrix. And this is breaking down this symmetry to the diagonal subgroup. So what is the vacuum manifold in this model? It's actually the coset SU2 left times SU2 right, or SU2 vectorial. And what is pi 3 of this thing? It's of course non-trivial. Actually, this is the same as pi 3 of SU2. So in principle, they can be skyrmionistic. But that was one point that was asked by Diego before. So the argument of Derek's theorem applies also even to the sigma model. It's not only for one single scalar field. It's for any number of scalar fields with any symmetry. Because you see the scaling of this thing is like a kinetic term for a scalar field. There's nothing hidden here. So basically, like this, they cannot be. There are no skyrmions in this model like this. Before going back to this, I want to emphasize why a much more simple way of seeing why this pi 3 of SU2 is actually Z. So all we did before, you can forget it if you want.
and look at something interesting. Is that there is an integral that we call it B, which is the integral over space of 1 over 24 pi square, the epsilon tensor in space, and then the trace. I have to start with Q dagger. Q dagger DIU EJ dagger DKU. Okay, this integral has some very this B of the matrix U.
Sorry, Mark.
Yes.
It's my silly question. This, why did you separate in SU left and SU right? SU left and SU right.
This one, because there is in this Lagrangian here, I can multiply U on the left by a global matrix, and this is multiply U dagger on the right. So this is a symmetry, but I can also multiply on the right, this is also a symmetry. So at the level of this Lagrangian, if you don't know what the vacuum is, in principle, you have this SU2 left times SU2 right symmetry. But only, of course, the vacuum, since U is a unitary matrix, it cannot be zero. I mean, the vacuum is non-trivial, so it breaks to SU2 diagonal, if you want. So that's why it's SU2. The symmetry of the model is only SU2. But this is a remnant of, if you want, in terms of the QCD, that you have this left and right symmetry. Okay.
Wait,
Yes.
I thought you took the homotopy group of the vacuum manifold, which I thought was SU2 vectorial. Why did you take the coset? Why did you take the
vacuum? So there is a difference between what is the symmetry of the Lagrangian and what is the vacuum manifold actually. The point is. Okay, in this case it's the same, huh? But what is the vacuum is if you want to, the Lagrangian is SU2 left times SU2 right symmetry, and then I pick one to be the true vacuum. I say now the vacuum is the identity, but I could have chosen the vacuum to be another thing. So any SU2 vectorial rotation is a pure choice, basically. So what is the true vacuum is really the full symmetry of the model, modulo what the freedom you have to choose the direction of your vacuum in your thing. So if you want, okay, maybe it's easier to see it directly in terms of SU2.
Okay.
So this is the symmetry of the model.
I see, you're okay.
Can you not simply say it's, you are interested in the homotopy group of the broken symmetry? Basically of all the ways you can non-trivially transform the vacuum.
Yeah.
Yes, if you want. Because then, for instance, you can do, you can write a sigma model for, I don't know, like this technical or theory we're talking about, this SU4 broken to SP4. And then what is relevant is SU4, the coset, the pi 3 of the coset SU4 to SP4.
In fact, if there is no broken symmetry, then you shouldn't expect any solitons, no? Because then there are no non-trivial inequivalent vacuum.
There could be the trivial vacuum plus other vacuum.
But in a certain sense, isn't that saying that you have a broken symmetry?
No.
Well, no, in
there
principle...
The absolute minimum is...
in principle, you can live with this sigma model.
Yeah, I mean, the standard model without the master...
Yeah, but you have solitons if you want in this sigma model.
Which are not symmetric.
There is no... Diego, in the sigma model, in principle, you don't know about... broken symmetry,
No, because you parameterize it from the start, you say.
Yes, but you can this one way of seeing it.
Is a description of
you can just see it as saying, okay, the only true symmetry in this model is SU2. Well, okay, I don't know.
But don't you also always associate these, generation of the skyrmions or solitons to broken symmetry always?
In general,
for instance, I mean, the domain wall that you mentioned is like the discrete symmetry and
Ah, exactly.
Sphinx
no.
is like a.
I think in all examples I know, indeed, it's related to.
Yeah,
but I don't see why it has to be like.
But I don't think it has to be. You can, in principle, you can study a theory like SO3 scalar theory by itself, and this has also solitons.
Mm-hmm.
In general, it's like this, but the only I don't have an answer to this. But it's a peculiar fact of QCD actually, of this SUN, that the coset, I mean the fiancé of this vectorial symmetry and the remaining symmetry and the broken symmetry are the same actually in this SUN, but okay, it's
but you have to have a non-trivial vacuum.
You have to have a non-trivial vacuum.
But one way of generating a non-trivial vacuum is by breaking some symmetry.
Yes.
Right.
Yes. But that's one way. Yeah, very good. So now I wrote down this thing, and this thing is called the winding number integral. And why is it like this? It has a number of properties. Now we always work upon the requirement that U at infinity is the identity, right? So then we can do integration by part, because any derivative of mu at identity at infinity is vanishing. With this requirement, first thing that you can check is that this integral is actually invariant under any change of u. So it is a topological integral. Any continuous transformation will not change this integral. So if you have a field, some configuration u, and you do a small modification, this thing remains the same. The way it works is, if you remove one u, you have to do it as an exercise, but since you have the epsilon ijk, and when you remove one u, you have to remove two, basically. You always have a u bag. Well, okay. This thing is vanishing, that is. And the same thing, what is very interesting, is that if you take b of u dagger, for instance, is minus b of u, and if you take b of, let's take a C2 matrix that is the multiplication of two SU2 matrices, this is b of u1 plus b of u2 plus boundary terms that vanish actually due to this thing. You can do the exercises, it's not very difficult. You just go to the same and you just check. You have to play a bit with the fact that u is unitary, and okay. So this thing means that for any SU2 matrix you compute, I mean SU2 field if you want, because it's a U of X, you compute this thing and you get a number that is the same for all deformation of this thing, and this number is additive if you take two of these fields. And the thing is, you can find a U that has the smallest number for this integral. And any other u will be a multiple of these numbers. And this is where the hedgehog enters the game. That's why I was saying that the Skyrmions are a bit of spikes. Is that the quantity that minimizes this bu that is non-zero, of course, because I mean, of course, b of the identity is zero. But you can, in principle, okay, let's take a field, u0 for instance, of x. I will do this ansatz that is called the hedgehog ansatz, which is to say this is I, a function of the radius. And then I take xi over r, so just an angle, times sigma I. And why is this called the hedgehog? Is that in terms, if you want to replace
you replace it by this, it means that it's the equivalent to saying that the field pi is just f of r xi over r. So basically, if you look at how this thing looks like in terms of the field pi, it always points towards the apart from the origin. So the field points in all directions like this. And this looks like a hedgehog to some people. I don't know what this is like to
Right, so it points outwards in this group.
In terms of this space, in the group space, yes.
But as a function of the spatial coordinates.
As a function of the spatial coordinates.
Links the space.
You can link the two. It's linking the space-time coordinate with the internal coordinate. Mm. And indeed, it has a
space-time with the group coordinate.
With the group coordinate, yes.
The change in
yes.
X1, it's
and as a consequence of this, for instance, is that since the group coordinates are invariant under a C2 transformation, then this is also invariant under any field configuration that you can build with these ansatz is going to be spherically symmetric, actually, because if you do a rotation, you do a group transformation. And the group transformation is a symmetry of the energy density. So the energy density of this is going to be a spherical symmetry. So this is called the hedgehog. And why is it nice? Okay, so this is not the end of the story of the hedgehog, because to be a well-defined field configuration, this function f of r must have some property. First, I was saying at infinity, we want it to be the identity. So this function f of infinity is zero. But this is fixed by this requirement. And then to be continuous, if you want to be able to take the derivative of this field u at the origin, actually, f of zero has to be a multiple of pi. You can just do the exercise of taking du of zero and ask the derivative to be continuous. And you'll find that you need it to be. It's clear by the fact that you cannot have a field pointing in all directions at zero. Basically. Very close to zero, it's pointing outwards. So at zero, you must have these. This exponential vanishes actually, and it will vanish for a multiple of pi, which is another exercise. Good. Okay, and the point is now, if you plug this in into this winding number integral, you get the following thing. So if I compute this b of u0, just a straightforward thing, you plug in this thing and you get 1 over 24 pi squared. Oh, sorry. Actually, there's a factor of 12, but minus 1 over 12. And then the integral over space of here we get sine of f of r, sine square of f of r. Times the derivative divided by r squared. So see, this thing only depends on the radial coordinates and not the angles because of this spherical symmetry. And this integral, you can just do it, right? Because this thing is just derivative. You can switch to spherical coordinates and you just get the point right here. And then you perform this integral. And what you get is 1 over pi, and then you have 1 half of sine 2f minus f, evaluated between r equals 0 and r from infinity, going to infinity. And with this boundary condition, this is just giving you. So see what this ansatz that we make actually gives provides you with the field configuration that have a winding number with unity. What is not trivial to see is that actually you cannot have other winding numbers than unity. The only thing I showed you here is that okay, this B of U is a number for any field, but I don't have any proof that this has to be integer, except that the fact that indeed this homotopy group is actually that. So this is, it's a way of seeing this thing in terms of the field. There is an integral that takes an integer number when you evaluate it on the given field.
So are there some uniqueness theorems that guarantees that when this works, the HR ends up is also the correct solution? Or could there be others?
The thing is, you can always deform the hedgehog, but
yeah.
If you deform it continuously, you stay in the
sure.
same number. So this hedgehog ansatz is a way to guarantee a non-zero winding number of the field. So it guarantees that actually you are in this non-trivial. Field configuration, basically.
Maybe I wasn't paying attention at the time, but B of U, is
yeah.
that something you... How do you get the idea to write down that?
You're a victim. No, you have the idea because it's basically you want to write down the topological invariant, so what you want is to have an epsilon tensor and
okay.
not contracting indices. And this is the other thing we can do, actually.
Okay, so
So
when you want an epsilon tensor, when you want a topological invariant, you want an epsilon tensor, and that's the obvious thing to do with
yes.
an epsilon tensor.
Because it does not depend. I mean, when you have an epsilon tensor integral, I mean, it does not depend on the. It depends only on the topology of the and this is the only thing you can write with an epsilon tensor. You can of course never have two derivatives acting on the same u.
Yeah.
So you need to have different u, and actually if you would like to do two traces or something like this, this thing is zero, the trace
yeah.
of this thing.
Well, you can add a few extra u's, couldn't you?
No, because the u dagger is one.
Yes.
That's an important point, because u is unitary. So even if you had want to add a u here,
yeah.
you have this property that biu dagger is minus u. The IU dagger. That also follows from the fact that UU dagger is one. So you can always permute the.
What?
There is no other way. It's the only integral you can write. The question is maybe then why is this one of the pi squared? This is just a choice that this
yeah.
thing is a multiplier. But this is the only topological quantity you can write in terms of the matrix U.
And if I use more epsilon tensors contracted on one index.
I don't know. I don't know, honestly.
Ijk, epsilon, k, lm.
But if you have more than one epsilon, no, I don't know.
Well, if you have a product, you want to contract epsilon indices with each other.
With okay. one index.
No, okay.
Yeah, well, then you can write that in terms of delta functions. There are a lot of relations between products of epsilons and double functions.
Okay, and that wouldn't work.
But were you thinking of higher order forms of
the topological objects of
maybe. I don't think so. I don't think so. Probably, but I don't
know. No. This is probably the lowest dimensional object I can give.
Yeah. I don't know. So anyway, now we are nearly there actually to build our first Skyrmion. Now we can go back to this Lagrangian, and of course, if you just plug in this hedgehog ansatz into this thing and you try to minimize the energy, actually you will not get anywhere. And the reason is just this scaling argument that was Derek's theorem. Basically, if you would find a solution, you could rescale it, and you'll find a solution that has even lower energy. So there is no solution that will have the minimum energy. Fortunately, you know, this
Phi on Lagrangian is just an effective description. So anyway, to get the physics right, you have to add other terms here. And terms with more derivatives. Of course, the terms with the least derivative are the most important at low energy. The only term with two derivatives is this one. But then you can have terms with four derivatives. And so in Lively, you could write four different terms. You can have terms with the double trace and everything. But it turns out that for SU2, there are only two terms that are linearly independent. And there is one term that is the trace of U dagger. And there is another term that is the trace with the indices U dagger, where the indices are like this. As an exercise, you can check that. The double trace. I have plenty of exercise for you guys.
Third,
you can check that if you do the double trace of this and this, you can rewrite it in terms of these two. And now the idea of Skyrm actually was to say, okay, I take a specific linear combination of those two terms with a minus sign here. And then I put some factor 1 over 16 e squared, which is a dimensionless coupling, the Skyrm coupling. And this is the Skyrm Lagrangian. Why is this? There are a number of reasons why to take this. In principle, you can have any two, you should have two different couplings, right? The first reason, which is amazing because it's a reason that I think was not known to Skyrm in 1961, is if you do the large NC expansion of Carrier perturbation theory, this is the leading term that you get. The other term with the plus is subleading. And this is also dominant by from pion scattering data. Well, that's an interesting thing. But this was probably not known to Skyrm. There is another reason, is that this is totally antisymmetric in Lorentz indices, actually. So you will not get from these terms with more than two time derivatives, actually. Which is totally irrelevant to now, but when we do the quantization, when you have only two time derivatives, you can use the canonical quantization, which is much easier. And the third reason is actually the reason that, that was a motivating Skyrm, is that when you write the Lagrangian in this way, you can do a beautiful trick. I mean, you can write the energy density, which, as always, for a static configuration, is just minus the Lagrangian. So the energy is just diu dagger trace. Then 11 minus 16 square. There is the fact that this have the minus one from the metric here, it's also when this stays with the plus sign. And then trace of T I U J dagger. Minus the trace of D I U dagger. D J U dagger. Very good. And now I can rewrite this thing as follows. Those of you who know the BPS bound in supersymmetry, for instance, for the BPS monopole, it's a bit the same trick. Is that I can rewrite this as the trace of... Oh wait, I think I forgot. Yeah, there is a phi square here on the 4. And I write it as f phi over 2. IU plus or minus 1 over 4 E epsilon tensor and then U TJ E dagger EK U times the same thing dagger. So the same as this in dagger. The trace of all these. So I get from, you know, the first part I get this, from this square I get these terms, and then I have to subtract twice the cross term actually. So minus or plus, depending if I keep plus or minus here. And the cross term that I have to subtract because I added without wanting is actually just this. Very good. Now why do we want to do this? Because this thing here is just this winding number integral here. And this thing here is the trace of an operator times its dagger. So this whole thing is Hermitian. So all it has only positive eigenvalues. So the trace is a positive number. So all this, we know that it's positive. Right? It can be zero if the derivative of u is exactly equal to this this thing here. But otherwise it's a positive number. So you know that the energy is basically bigger than this, and you have to check the factor of 24 pi squared. What you get is actually is bigger than 6 pi squared f pi over e times this b. Very good. So it means that basically this Lagrangian, you know that when you look at the field configuration that has a non-zero winding number, you know that this has some given energy. There is a lower bound on the energy. So you know that this has to be stable, actually, this field configuration. And it turns out, actually, for...
Is there a minus plus in front of it?
There is a... Well, it's why I put it in absolute value, right? Because you can... choose, you have both possibilities.
Yes.
So you can always, it's always bigger than minus the charge and plus the charge. So whatever the sign of the charge, this is bigger than the absolute value of the charge. So if you know that if you have one of these Skyrmions, because this is going to be a Skyrmion, with winding number 1, so b equal 1, you know that it's going to have a mass bigger than 6 pi squared f pi over e. Just to give you an idea, F pi is around because this we know F pi is around 100 GeV, 100 MeV, 93 or whatever, 100 MeV. And this factor of E, if you get it from the data on the pion scattering, is around 5. So this is around 100 and this is around 5, so this gives 20 MeV. So this is, the mass is more or less 6. Pi, 6 pi is, I have it somewhere, this is 80, so, no, it's 60, 59. Around pi squared is 10. So it's 60 times 20 is bigger than 120 than that. It's, you know, the mass of the Skyrmion is around GeV.
Yeah.
Very good, which is nice, because you get it from, okay, this is just a bound. And this is called the Bogomolny bound. Because it was invented by Skyrm, of course. No, I don't know why it's always called the Bogomolny bound, but Bogomolny did it for the BPS monopole, basically the Bogomolny Prandtl Sommerfeld. But it's the same trick. So, but this was done by Skyrm.
You plus minus there. That's a choice.
It's a choice. You have both possibility.
Okay.
So you know that it's bigger than minus this thing, but it's also bigger than plus this thing.
Yeah.
So it's always bigger than the absolute value.
It's also bigger than minus the absolute value.
It's also bigger than
but this is a more interesting.
It's a bit, this one is more interesting.
Yeah.
So why do you call it a mass?
Because it's the energy. I mean, okay. You have a field people. Configuration that.
That's
of course, it's not a particle. It's not a particle. But it's localized in space. It's energy localized in space, if you want. So from far away, it looks like energy somewhere. And this energy, so it looks like a particle. So I call it a mass.
Can you scatter them? Can you have an energy momentum?
You can do the same thing as for the sine Gordon King.
Yeah.
You can boost them when they are far away. You know that they are going to be. They are very well separated. The approximation of them being alone is very good. And then you can do, there are people doing the numerics of these things.
So what are the quantum numbers of this part?
This is a bit the next lecture, because so it's
but I can do it effectively.
But I can make
this,
you...
this is classical, so natural doesn't have any quantum numbers yet.
Yes, it doesn't have.
What do you mean it's classical? It's a field theory.
It's a field theory, but there is no quantization so far. But then we will quantize this thing, which is a bit different from the usual quantization. Right? But the amazing thing is, it's a theory of scalars, and when you quantize it, you get a fermion. No, but it's... So
wait,
it's great.
I don't know if I missed what you said about E. So here you just choose E so that this is one GV.
No, this is from scattering data, pion scattering data, more or less.
So you match with the 4 coefficients.
Yes, exactly. You do. I mean, it's very broad because truth is then there is also the thing with the opposite sign that can also be there. But. An order of magnitude is order 1.
You're aiming at a path integral, and then you will be able to give quantum numbers to this scale, or what?
Yes, then this is what we do next week. Okay. Now, basically, the only thing, if you want, I can tell you that is remaining, is, I don't want to do it too long, is that indeed, so now the question is, we have a bound, we don't know yet the mass of this thing. But in ink, for any number one, the hedgehog ansatz gives the lowest solution. And if you plug in this hedgehog ansatz, you remember it was, I think I erased it, right? But it was with an arbitrary function f of r. With winding number one, we had the boundary condition that f of 0 must be pi. And f of infinity was going to be 0. You have to solve this numerically. It's not. I have the equations there, but I will put this thing online, so you can just look at the equation. They are not so exciting, I think. You solve this numerically, you get this function f. You get an energy distribution that is looks like this. So actually, this is 0 around 0. The energy as a function of the radius. It is peaked around 1 over Fe, F pi E, in unit F, like this. And it has a mass or an energy, if you want, energy of the thing that is actually 72.9 F pi over E. So it's just a bit, it's not saturating the bound, actually. You cannot find a solution. Because you could do, like, for a DPS monopole, basically look for a solution that satisfies, that makes this zero, actually. But there are no solutions to this equation. And this is around 60. So this is a bit bigger than this bound.
There are no solutions, is it proven, or is it just...
Yes, well, you can try it, it doesn't work.
Within the ansatz or more generally?
I don't know how you do it more generally, but there is a formal proof that the hedgehog ansatz is indeed the lowest energy solution for the one number one, which is, I don't know, actually the proof. The usual argument is the solution with the biggest symmetry is the best.
Mm.
This seems to work, but okay. But then it's not the case for winding number bigger than 1. If you take the Skyrmion with winding number 2, it's not the hedgehog solution that's going to give you the thing. And this, you can see it, I mean, it's somewhat intuitive in the sense that it means that, I mean, it's intuitive if you think of this as being a proton, right? You have the winding number 2, is not two protons on top of each other and it's really symmetric. It's something where, I mean, two proton and a neutron, for instance. And indeed, to find the solution of winding number 2, then to find a higher winding number, you have to use this rational map, ansatz, and something like this, which gets very complicated. They are beautiful. People have computed the solution up to winding number 128. No, but therefore, for given winding numbers, you can use beautiful tricks on this. It looks very, 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 I mean, I should show you actually the the plot of the energy distribution of big solutions, because it's very symmetric, it's very, very beautiful. But for instance, last thing I could say is that for the winding number 2, there is a solution that still has some symmetry, actually, that has an actual symmetry. So you do like the hedgehog ansatz, basically, but you allow the function f to be a function of the radius and of one angle, basically, in one direction. And then you minimize this, so you have a two-dimensional differential equation. And you do this, and what you get is that the energy of the b equal 2 solution, so this is the energy of the b equal to 1, the energy of the b equal to 2 solution is, I just forgot it, I looked at it, I forgot it, it's 139.6, which doesn't tell much. But it's just a little bit less than twice the mass of the b equal 1 solution. Which means that there exists a bound state of 2 Skyrmions. Because this is not trivial. In principle, you could have the fact that the winding number 2 solution, I mean, that there is no better solution than having 2 separate winding number 1. But there is one, but the difference is very little. And this is very nice, because it's exactly what happens in QCD, actually. Is that the deuteron, the bound state of a proton and a neutron, has a binding energy that is 2.2 MeV, while the mass of the thing is 2 GeV, so it has a very little very small binding energy. And this has huge consequences for cosmology, because if the binding energy of the deuteron was different, the whole universe would be different, right?
I think it has consequences for everyone.
Also
for us, I agree. Although, I do think the world revolves around me, so I guess...
But, so at least this thing, now it was only at the classical level, you can quantize this thing, there will be correction to the mass, but you already see that you find this nice thing that... You have this thing that looks like a particle, if you want, from far away at least. Energy localized classically, energy localized in a point. When you put two of them together, you can bind them with the binding energy is very tiny. And of course you have winding number 1, plus 1 and minus 1, you can, if you take two of them, you can annihilate. I mean, of course at the classical level, it's only going to scatter or something like this, but you get a very nice coherent picture already at the classical level of baryons.
And so if we take this seriously, like, baryons are like shells, because the energy is more
The energy, they have no energy in the center, actually. Yeah. But actually, the best models that exist, I mean, the MIT bug models and something like this, they're based on this, actually. Yeah. It's a hybrid of saying, okay, there is a regime where you put free quarks, and the regime where you put a Skyrmion tail, actually. So they are not very good models.
The quarks are so close that they don't feed each other, and only if they start, they try to get away from each other.
It's very interesting. Actually, there are a number of things you can do. Also, you can add also terms with them with 6 derivatives or something like this, and play with what you can do just at the classical level is already quite. Without limits. You can do a lot of numerical, and then it gets very complicated to get the higher winding number solution. Yes. Last thing, maybe, is there was one thing I didn't put is the pion massive. And you can add it just to the Lagrangian by actually adding something like that. I'm pi squared at pi squared 4. And trace a few dagger, which is going to preserve parity. Minus 4, so 0 when you use the identity. You can add the pion mass like this, and it's basically not changing it will change the number, of course, here, because you get an additional parameter that you can play with. You have 3 parameters, but it's going to change one thing, is that the profile function, this is the profile function f, that was going as 1 over r square. In this case, when you have the pion masses, it becomes exponential. So as soon as the pion has a small mass, then basically the energy of the
of the soliton is exponentially decreasing here, not just power law, which is also makes sense physically, I mean intuitively, right? So pion cannot extend, if they are massless, they can propagate much further away from the bound state. Okay, I think yes, we're done for today. It was long enough already. But I don't know. But what about next week, same time?
I would like to be at the next one, and I will not be here next week.